I now invite our next dignitary, Dr. the Honorable Timothy S. Harris, Prime Minister of the Federation of St. Christopher and Nevis from 18th of February 2015 to present.
Mr. President, sir, arise at your leave, and I would wish firstly to thank you for extending the kind invitation for me to participate in this important National Assembly or Nevis Island Assembly meeting to address the matter of the Christina disaster some 50 years hence. I want to adopt the protocol so ably laid before me, but it would be remiss of me were I not to recognize the members of the NIA and to thank them for agreeing to this particular event, and in particular, the premier of the Nevis Island Assembly. I want equally to recognize our first Prime Minister, the Right Honorable and the Right Excellent Sir Kennedy Alphonse Simmons. I must recognize also the Leader of the Opposition, the Right Honorable Denzel Douglas. I recognize my former colleague and former Premier of Nevis, the Honorable Vance Amory, my cousin, former Premier Joseph Parry, and I recognize equally our Speaker, the Honorable Speaker of the Federal Parliament, my classmate, Mr. Michael Perkins, the Honorable Michael Perkins, the Governor General's deputy, and her husband, and all those who are especially invited to today's event, and in particular, to bid welcome to the Deputy Speaker, Dr. Bernicia Nisbet of the Federal Parliament. I stood and I listened and learned a lot from the vivid recollections of those who were there at the time and lived through it. I confess that I have no direct memory of this disaster. I was born, but yet still too young to have been too far from my grandmother's yard, I guess. So I have no direct recollection of it. I am the son of a Nevisian gentleman, Godfrey Nisbet, who hails from the deep lands of Nevis and Cotton Ground. And I am the son of a Kittishan woman, Margaret Harris, from the village of Tabernacle. And so I am a true product of the federal enterprise, the federal nation building exercise in which we are all engaged. Reflecting back 50 years ago today, the associated state of St. Kitts and Nevis suffered what we may describe as a catastrophic ferry loss when on the afternoon of Saturday the 1st, August 1970, the MV Christina, a government-owned and operated ferry, took on water and sank as it entered the Narrows just off of Nag's Head. 50 years, of course, in the life of an individual or country, by any stretch of the imagination, is a significant time frame which can impact many generations, at least two. Therefore, I want to join with you in this memorial ceremony to observe the very traumatic event that is part of the lived history of the people of the Federation of St. Kitts and Nevis. Today we are here to remember, to pay tribute to, and honor the legacy of those who lost their lives in the Christina disaster. We also offer solace to the survivors who are still with us and to the families of those who perished way back then. Each year, this ceremony brings back vivid and detailed memories of that catastrophe, and today was no exception. I believe that those of you who were adults at that time, and we did hear it today, can recall exactly where you were when it happened and how you reacted. We heard this from Sir Kennedy, from Vance, from Parry, and from Denzel, all the speakers before me. No doubt, from time to time, you, the survivors and families of the victims, react to triggers which remind you of the pain and horror associated with this horrific event. But no matter how painful, it is an event which we must never forget. In the history of all great people and nations, they are defining moments that last throughout the ages. Some are economic, some are political, some are natural, while others are social. Then there are those seemingly singular events that touch, affect, and affect all segments of a society. The sinking of the MV Christina on August 1st, 1970, arguably was such an event for the people of St. Kitts and Nevis. True, from the recounting today, Nevis bore the brunt of the loss of lives and the hurt to the economy and people. But let it not ever be mistaken, or indeed taken, that this was somehow a Nevis disaster. This event must be documented and viewed as it was and still is a national disaster of St. Kitts and Nevis that engulfed the entire associated state of St. Kitts and Nevis with its strong family ties, its friendship and work and business relationships. We are here 50 years later to recall this tragedy and to remember the 200 plus souls that perished when Christina slipped below the waves. We heard the figure recounted of 240, we have heard 232. From the reports of the commission which was released in October, we were clear that the appropriate arithmetic could not be relied upon because some of the processes which will normally attend to persons embarking on the boat were not fulfilled as dutifully as it ought to. Hence, perhaps, we can say 200 plus, and that will clear any inaccuracy with the details. We come to celebrate the strength and the resilience of some 91 survivors. And in my view, it is a testament to the transformative nature of the event and the nation, and the people of Nevis, and the people of St. Kitts. But on a day like today, when we gather to remember, we must be mindful of the fact and sensitive to the reality that this day with its ordeal is something survivors like Livingstone Sargent, Oswald Ossie Tyson, Diane Williams Richards, and Ian Kelsick would never forget. Nor would the family of Ivan Buchanan, then Chief Public Health Inspector, forget. It was, and you heard this before me, a young Kittishan doctor named Dr. Kennedy Simmons, who treated the first survivors at the Alexander Hospital. Later on that day, it would be the late Dr. Cuthbert Sebastian from the island of St. Kitts who would take over from Dr. Simmons, continuing the care and treatment of the survivors on the island of Nevis. Back then, those two men had no idea what history had in store for them. They were just doing what needed to be done for their fellow citizens. I say to all of you who are working day in and day out, putting country above self, that God will bless you. And you do not know the hour or the day, so be open to God's grace every day. Way back then, Dr. Kennedy Simmons now saw Kennedy with a long list of titles appended to his name. He's now here today as our first Prime Minister and only living national hero. He became our first Prime Minister on September 19, 1983, after negotiating the St. Kitts and Nevis Constitution Order 1983, which now provides the supreme law in which the relationship between the islands of St. Kitts and Nevis and our government and people is to be constructed and fashioned. Our second Kittishan doctor, Sir Cuthbert Sebastian, 26 years after the Christina disaster, would rise to the pinnacle of national service as the second Governor General of an independent St. Kitts and Nevis on January 1, 1996. If national tragedy indeed tests the mettle of a people, the people of Nevis and St. Kitts demonstrated superhuman strength and resilience immediately following the disaster and in the ensuing 50 years. It is said that every family in Nevis lost someone. Vance told us that. Indeed, losing 200 plus citizens in a single event from a small population would test the fortitude of even those who were not on board. A disaster by any measure, be it by the raw numbers or on a per capita basis, it is still the worst maritime disaster in the English-speaking Caribbean. The loss of so many lives at one time was incomprehensible. The victims included people you would have heard from all walks of life, rich and poor perished, parents lost children, some parents lost their only child, others lost as many as three children. Children too lost parents, and some became orphans. Errol Liebert and his surviving siblings come to mind. Household lost breadwinners, husbands and wives lost spouses. Some families lost several members, and family life, Mr. Parry told us, was shattered in many cases. The victims of this disaster included three Canadian nuns. Every community in both St. Kitts and Nevis was affected by this tragedy. It is a question of degrees. Everyone in St. Kitts and Nevis had a relative, a friend or acquaintance, or co-worker who had either perished or survived. The trauma and pain, indeed, were overwhelming. Survivors suffered physical injuries. They endured mental and emotional problems then and for many years after. Some continue to suffer, even up today, if we were to take the logic of Mr. Parry's presentation. Communities, indeed, would have been devastated. So consider Ossie Tyson, who who lost his mother and sister, and I'm advised to brothers, left practically alone by his own account, was raised by the grandmother of a fellow survivor. That survivor, Livingstone Sargent, was only 10 years old at the time of the sinking. I understand that they have become lifelong friends. Only 12 years old when he went into the water, as he survived the ordeal and the trauma of loss to become a successful businessman and later an author, having documented his ordeal in a published book, it is this strength and resilience in the face of a calamity that has become characteristic of our Kitishan and Nivision people that largely brought the islands and the nation to this difficult tragedy. Out of tragedy, what can come of it? Unfathomable then, and maybe even incomprehensible now, incomprehensible now, is the purpose of such tragedy. And there are those of us who may even say now, 50 years after, that there was and there is no purpose for such colossal loss of life and deep human suffering. And then someone will say to us, think of Job and his own disaster. Think of Joseph, written somewhere in Genesis, and we begin to get a better appreciation. What can come out of tragedy? We are mindful that we believe in an omnipotent God and an existence where nothing happens but by his will. And if it is his will, then there must be a purpose. We may never understand the why of this tragedy on this side of eternity, but we know that we can cling to the knowledge that God does not willingly grieve or afflict us. On consideration, I would want to believe and to encourage you also to believe that his purpose was to ignite in us that strength and resilience, togetherness and shared responsibility necessary for us to build an independent St. Kitts and Nevis. Even today, in the face of this COVID-19 global pandemic, to which former Premier Parry made reference, this global pandemic threatening our economic gains and social norms, we must rely even more on that strength and solidarity, resilience and shared responsibility exhibited and embedded in us a half a century ago when Christina slipped below the waters of the Narrows. Let us therefore no longer look upon or refer to those who perish, nor those who suffer the ordeal as victim, but as heroes. Heroes whose sacrifices forge in us those characteristics that have ensured our continued success as a people and a nation. As we enjoy unprecedented cooperation between the islands, no longer is it sufficient to remember them, but indeed we must equally honor them. Very importantly, the Christina disaster highlighted serious deficiencies in ferry and other areas of maritime safety, and this came vividly from the recount of former Premier Vance Amory and others before me. Out of this tragic and painful situation came positive impacts, both for individuals and for the country as a whole. As Susan L. Taylor once wrote, in every crisis there is a message. Crises are nature's way of forcing change so that something new and something better can take its place. End of quote. While in some ways This disaster caused much bitter sorrow and exposed rifts between St. Kitts and Nevis. In many ways, it also demonstrated the capacity of our people to work together to mitigate the immediate situation and to build a better future. The fact that by 1983, we were ready to move forward as an independent nation, albeit with clauses 110 and 113, is an indication of the maturity of our leaders then and now. They knew that in spite of their insular stance, the whole of St. Kitts and Nevis was greater than its individual parts, and they embraced that big picture. They knew the truth of the parable in 1 Kings chapter 3, verses 16 to 28. The baby, the associated state of St. Kitts and Nevis, could not be divided in two, half for Nevis and half for St. Kitts. They opted in the end for unity, and it also emphasized how intertwined the people of St. Kitts and Nevis really are and always were, because despite the travailing and the distancing between the political leadership, always between the people of St. Kitts and Nevis, there were strong bonds. Van spoke of his own education in St. Kitts, and there were several others. I went to sixth form with the now Speaker of the National Assembly many, many years ago. And with us, there were about two other Nevisians attending sixth form at the Barstair High School then. The numbers now are even larger at the CFBC College. Many vessel operators from both the island of St. Kitts and the island of Nevis immediately rose to the challenge and gave of their expertise and other resources to rescue passengers and recover the dead. Medical and other health personnel from both islands work hand in hand to provide relief. There were many people of goodwill who reached out and provided care for orphans and gave comfort and support to the devastated families. Over time, this tragedy has helped us as a people to build character, confidence, and resilience, and develop coping mechanisms to deal with and address this horror that was beyond our individual and collective comprehension. Our faith in God, no doubt, sustained us. With strength and courage, we nurtured each other and grew stronger each day. We picked ourselves up, and carry on rebuilding lives and livelihoods. Despite the trauma and the scars, St. Kitts and Nevis look optimistically to a brighter, safer, and stronger future. It must be noted that the Christina disaster led to significant changes and improvements in maritime safety regulations and protocols. Today we are the beneficiaries of such improvements. These include regular inspection of maritime vessels, limits on the number of passengers, provision of life jackets, and certified and experienced operators and crew. Today, citizens, residents, and visitors can travel between our two islands confidently with the knowledge that safety measures are in place and are being adhered to, and that improvements are ongoing. The site of the Christina disaster is an underwater heritage site, as it is the final resting place for the doomed boat, as well as for some of its passengers. Perhaps it is time that we consider implementing regulations that govern access by divers to that underwater wreckage site. I recall that the St. Kitts and Nevis Observer newspaper interviewed me some 23 years ago for an article that was published on the 1st February 1997, titled "Sacrilege or History: Diving the Christina Wreck." At the time, I was Minister of Agriculture and Fisheries. I said then that the area may be considered special and requires some policy. I also said that it would be important to gain some public consensus on the matter of whether diving should be allowed at the Christina wreck site. Perhaps the 50th anniversary is as propitious a time as any to put these ideas into action. Perhaps we can look at making it a protected or regulated wreck dive site, where, for instance, divers would only be allowed to view the sunken boat from the outside, and they would have to avoid contact with the remains of the boat when taking photos and video. Legislation such as a Historic Wrecks Act would be required in order to preserve and safeguard St. Kitts and Nevis's underwater cultural heritage of momentous importance to the people of St. Kitts and Nevis. In closing, life, in my view and my limited experience, is never without challenges. The Christina disaster brought the noblest of the human spirit to the fore and taught us, among other things, that every challenge we face and navigate strengthens our will, our confidence, and ability to conquer future obstacles. Let us continue to work together to face our challenges as a nation with unity, with courage, resolve, and abiding faith in God. Parry had it right. Out of disaster can come some good, and several of those good things have been enumerated today. Disaster certainly too can bring out the worst or the best within us. In my view, 50 years after the Christina disaster, we are building a stronger and safer future together. May it please you, Mr. President, I thank you for the invitation.